the Weekly Extra Point Live. I'm your host, Mo Khan. With me for the Roadshow edition, that is correct, Roadshow 6, Ray Starwar, who is a wily veteran of the Spring League titles. Isn't that correct?
The first spring season, I'm not in the finals, but you know what? It doesn't matter because we have some good games today.
And his Usher hat, need I say.
Thanks, Mo Khan. Compliment coming from you is always nice.
As always, let's look at the Division B finals here with Prestige Worldwide against the G-Men, two teams that were essentially in the top three of Division B throughout the entire season here. First question I have for you is Alex Lever, 42 touchdowns this past season here against a G-Men's defense, which is very strong, but also their offense, which can score points at a premium. Does he have to milk the clock on his side of the ball to really limit the number of possessions for the G-Men?
I think he'll have to. I mean, you know, don't forget that he has the weapons to go deep anytime he wants. I mean, with guys like, you know, Wesley Joseph, guys like Phil Leduc, guys like Patrick Jerome, he has all the necessary tools to go deep. But I think his strategy has to be, you know, to keep Johnny Nicotino off the field on the offense. So milk that clock. You know, you have guys like Frank Grenier, you have guys like Matthew Berthier, who can take those short yardage, you know, and keep on marching on the field. Keep the Giants' defense on most of the time, and I think if you can
Giants, you talking about Osi Nyumanura?
Well, you know, G-Man, Giants. Paul would be happy if I say Giants. So, but regardless, I mean, if the G-Man offense can stay off the field, I think that's a good thing for Lever.
All right, let's look at Giannis Citino, a young quarterback who's definitely flourished with the G-Man up till now. Most likely, the next quarterback for the G-Man in winter 2011 here.
Yeah.
Is there pressure on him, given the fact that he's still green in the sense that he's playing some big time football now in FPF? So is there a little bit of pressure on him to really perform? Last week, 14 of 19, do you think he'll feel it?
You know what? I don't think he feels the pressure. When you speak to him, he seems very casual. It seems very laid back. I think he takes the game, you know, with a lot of fun, you know. And not only that, I think the guys around them are also the same caliber. You know, they've been here before, so they keep him in, you know, in good strides. So I think I like Johnny's going to have fun out there. I don't think he feels any pressure at all because he knows that he'll be with this team for probably seasons to come. I think he's excited to be here at this point, and I think he probably can't wait for that first pass. But you know, a guy like Johnny, he probably should get a couple of passes in the beginning to get it out of the way, and then I think when he gets the rhythm, he won't feel any pressure at all.
One player that we've always talked about throughout the history of the WEPL is Narayan, and what he has done,
the jump ball receiver,
as Ross Kasten would always allude to.
Yeah.
Can they stop him on defense for the Prestige Worldwide?
I think it'll be really extremely tough, but honestly, if there's one defense that could stop him, it's probably Prestige Worldwide. Again, with the guys they have in the backfield, like Wesley Joseph, like Patrick Jerome, you could match him one-on-one. But thinking Narek too is a big body. You know, he runs the route well. He has good hands. So, you know, can you stop him? I don't think you can stop him flat out, but I think you'll probably limit his catches here and there. But I think a guy like Narek also, he understands he's played football with some of the better players in tackle programs. So I think he understands that if he's covered, he can change his coverage around. He can get open if he has to. So I don't think you can completely stop him though, but you probably could limit his mobility a little bit.
Finally, who has the advantage here? Would you say that the Prestige Worldwide receivers or the secondary of the G-Men have the advantage in this football game?
If I had to pick one more, I'd probably go with the receivers off the Prestige Worldwide, only because I find, you know, you look at the big names. Again, I've mentioned them in this interview over and over again. You have Phil Leduc, Wesley Joseph, Patrick Jerome. But I think you're looking at also guys like, you know, Trudeau, guys like Grenier, guys like Brethor. I think they have a lot of depth, whether they want to go short, they want to go deep. They have all the tools. So I would prefer that over the G-Men secondary because as strong as they are, I don't think they can match up well, you know, every snap over and over again. There's too many guys on Prestige World that can make a play. So I would have to go with the receiver. I think there's more depth there.
Finally, it's prediction time now for Division B. Who will be hoisting the trophy in a few hours' time? Will it be PWW or W, because it might be winners at the end, or will it be the G-Men?
Well, think about it.
Prestige Worldwide winners.
I just think about what you just said, but anyways, in all honesty, I would have to give the nod to Prestige Worldwide. I just think that Johnny Citino, it's his first time in the finals. He might have a bit of a tough time. I think he'll have fun regardless because, you know, he's playing with, you know, a good group of guys. But I think, you know, with Prestige Worldwide, it's business every week. And I think the tools that Alex Lever has at his disposal, he's going to use them all wisely. He's also become a premier quarterback himself. You just mentioned 42 touchdown passes in the regular season. That's nothing to sneeze at all. So if I have to pick right now, I think Prestige Worldwide, by a small margin, probably takes his championship.
So there you have it, the Division B recap by Ray Starwar. He likes PWW to add another W to their name by the end of the night.
So P3W.
Exactly. Stay tuned for the pregame interviews and for the Division B highlights coming up next.
Welcome to the Division B championship game interview. I'm here with Frank Grenier of Prestige Worldwide. Congrats on getting this far.
Thank you, man.
So you've been in this league a long time. What does it feel to finally get to the epicenter of Division B spring season?
It's a very cool feeling. It's just a shame that I couldn't get there with my QB skills, which are probably not there. But it's very fun to play on that team, awesome team, and I think we can win it all today.
I think it'd definitely be a very close matchup. What do you expect to see from G-Men, considering all the talent from upper divisions that they have?
Well, they have a pretty basic playbook. It's always short hooks or long, deep ones. They don't have a lot of other patterns, but they're very creative with those short ones, so I think we can take them.
And you've played quarterback in the past. You've also played alongside your quarterback, Alex Lever, who was a quarterback for the Cobras. How does it feel watching him excel as a quarterback now in one of the higher divisions of the league?
Well, we all knew he was going to get there one time, but you just have to put very talented players with him. And yeah, I'm talking about myself. I'll include myself even if I have two catches.
Has there ever been a chance where you might have stepped in to throw for Preston Rogoy?
I could have, but I seem to always get hurt when that happens. So, but I've been portrayed as a big water boy mascot, two catch a game player, and I can live with that since I'm in the final.
The killer hooks.
Yeah, killer hooks. That's me.
And on your team, basically, what's the dynamic behind the scenes? Who do you think steps up the most, you know, when things aren't going well to right the ship?
Actually, everybody steps up on that team. That's what's awesome about it. Everybody makes plays, and Alex distributes the ball everywhere. And every time it's heating up a little, but we have people that step in, like Pat Jerome's messing around. I bring water and tell stupid things, and we get calm and we win.
All right, well, congratulations on getting this far, and good luck in the finals.
Thanks, man.
I'm here with Paul Kamel, captain of the G-Men, just minutes before their game, so we'll try to make this short and sweet. Paul, first of all, I know you've been in a championship game before. You obviously have extensive experience in flag post football. How's the mood of the team in general and for yourself as captain going into this game?
We're very calm. We're confident. I mean, we've been having a good season so far, so hopefully we'll just continue in doing what we're doing all season, do that today.
All right, now it's been an interesting contrast between your team and Prestige Worldwide. They had a relatively tough regular season. You know, they were never dominating, and then in the playoffs they've had a cakewalk. You guys have been completely the opposite. You guys had really, like, you know, you guys dominated a lot of your competition in the regular season. Playoffs has been very, very tough. How has that changed your mindset going into this game?
Hasn't really changed our mindset because we go into every game the same way. Whatever the outcome happens, it happens. But, I mean, they're a good team, we're a good team, so it should be a dogfight.
All right, now going to your quarterback, Johnny Satino. He has the distinction of being the only member on your entire team who has not won a championship before in flag plus football. How do you feel about his confidence, how he's developed, and how you feel he's going to do in this game?
Johnny, surprisingly, is the most confident on the team right now. He's very calm, cool, and collected, as opposed to everybody else on the team. You know, we're very anxious, and we want to get on the field, but I have all the confidence in Johnny for sure.
All right, going a bit to Prestige Worldwide side, now obviously their big threat is Patrick Jerome and their second big threat is Phil LeDuc. Both these guys have been terrorizing opposing defenses. Obviously you guys are known for having a very stout defense. What do you guys foresee changing anything defensively, or are you just going to play your game? If so, what do you think you guys are going
to
do?
I don't think so. I mean, guys like that, you can only hope to stop completely. You know, you want to just contain them, limit their catches. Lever's going to look for them. Lever's going to find them. That's just the way it's going to be. We're not going to change our game plan big time. We have a few things that we're going to do, but we'll see what happens.
All right, and the last thing I want to bring up now, the rumor going around is, confirm or deny, will Nathan Taylor be here tonight?
He will not.
And so how does that change how you guys game plan? Who will be moving into his spot? What will be happening going?
It doesn't change anything in our game plan. We're just going to plug in some more players and move around. It's going to be the same game plan as is, and we're going to go with what we have.
Basically the championship G-Men team plus Narag at this point, and Johnny?
Pretty much, yeah.
All right. Well, look, on that, any parting shots, last words to say, predictions on the outcome or anything you want to say before the game so you can look like a genius post-game if you guys win?
There's a lot of firepower on the field today on both sides, so it's going to be a really, really entertaining game for everybody to see.
I would have to agree with that. So that's it with Paul Kamel, and now on to the game film.
Hi, I'm here at the halftime of the Prestige Worldwide versus G-Men Division B Championship. Right now, Prestige is losing 26-12. And the mood is pretty calm right now. I mean, they start with the ball on offense, so they're able to get back in this with one score. They'll obviously need to cut down on the drops and the big plays from the G-men. A couple defensive assignments were blown and thus resulted in touchdowns. But overall, I think they do have a belief in themselves that they can come back, and they're looking upbeat in order to win that Division B championship trophy. Now I'll send it to Darren, who's on the G-men, who are looking pretty good at this point.
Right here on the G-men sideline, the mood is pretty good. They're obviously in the lead by two scores now. That's right where they want to be, but they're not resting on their laurels. They're not thinking that the game is over. They're discussing what adjustments to do, specifically defensively. They know that Lever is going to have to try and go a bit deeper, so they're just making sure that they adjust and take account of that, make sure they don't get beat deep and give up quick plays. Beyond that, they're pretty confident. They do believe that Prestige Worldwide looks a little bit frazzled, so they just want to make sure that they capitalize on all their opportunities and maintain the gap as it is right now all the way through to the end of the game. That's it for us, and we'll see you back to the highlight film.
that you don't have that pass on. One, two, three, shots!
I like the shirt of my captain DK, who came out big in the last game.
I'm here with the freshly minted Division B champion, G-Men. Gianni Satino, quarterback, Paul Kamel, Alex Kamis, Faris Kamel, Daniel Kalla, and Narek Yesayan. The last one being the playoff MVP.
Can you get in here, please?
Okay, so first question, and I'll ask it to the guy who's closest to me. Another guy who could have won. There's like four potential playoff MVPs on this team. But first question, because it's closest. Gianni, it's your first time winning a championship in Flag Plus football. You're the only one on the team who hadn't won one. So tell me, how does it feel?
It feels great. I'm trying to sound not cliched, but there's nothing I can say. It just feels amazing, and it's what we've been working for the whole season. And just to see it happen is great. So I'm happy, and I'm sure these guys are happy. So.
Well, I hope so. If you guys aren't happy, you can all leap. Very understated the comment from quarterback Gianni Satino, who's been like that, I guess, all
He's
season, right? Yeah. Kerry Collins. Yeah, exactly. Well, I'll move on down the line. Paul Kamel, who had a huge game today. You know, we always say if it was a finals MVP or a playoffs MVP, it's a different story. Narek got screwed out of a playoff MVP last time because of that back in my days. But right now, Paul, obviously you came up big in the biggest game. Talk to me about your team's effort.
We all played great, man. We fed off each other. It was a shame that we were missing Nathan today, but we still had our game plan. We went strong with it. We plugged in. My brother stepped up big on defense, few pass deflections, and I'm just so proud of everybody.
All right, well, let's talk about the game itself right now. I'll come to you, Alex. Obviously, you guys started off on fire. You had a two-score lead, and you maintained it for a while. Then it got kind of close. So tell me, what were the thoughts going through your guys' minds? How did you know that you had to retake focus? What did you guys have to do? What adjustments did you have to make?
Stay confident. We stayed with the same plan. I gave up some big plays. I take responsibility for that. But we all just stay together. I mean, kept the game plan. And Johnny came solid through, man. Johnny and Narek, the Warriors. And John Young, especially. JY, too. And I even said it in the press conference that he was going to come out big, and I'm glad he did. I even said it.
That's one of the good things you said at the press conference. The last line on the press conference, not so much, but all right, well.
All I can say is more confident.
I hope the mic didn't pick that one up. All right, so moving on now to playoff MVP. Narek, obviously, look, you have. I've played with you before. Obviously, we won a championship together, but your playoffs this time is the best I've ever seen you play in Flag Plus football. Talk to me about your team. What happened, and what was it that allowed you to take your game to this level this season?
Honestly, it's the surrounding cast, and every time we're together, we talk about it. It's ridiculous how every single time we play, every single player makes a play. Through the rusher, the corners, the DBs, everyone steps up. Even when they're put into a situation that they don't usually play, like Faris played defense, he hadn't played defense all year, and he batted down like three balls. John Young, receiver, he barely played this year, but he came up with two of the sickest catches, momentum swings. It basically comes down to that, the surrounding cast, and I can't give enough credit to Mr. Gianni Satino, FBF's next star. Please get that on camera, and it's all due to him, because Adam played with a QB his caliber.
Not even Miles?
Well, can't count Miles as professional, but.
All right, moving on. Faris Kamel, my nemesis. Yep. But congratulations on the championship win. Obviously, your whole team has said, you were forced into a difficult spot here. Came up with a huge, huge game. I mean, obviously, you've played defense before, but this season, not so much time. Tell me about how it was to step into that role and come up with the big plays you did.
I've been playing in this league for about 5 years now, so I mean, it's nothing new to me, but not playing defense all year. Like they said, the supporting cast was there, and I mean, we didn't really get a test till the first game of the playoffs this year, so the fact that we're in a dogfight from game one, game two, and then game three, we were ready. So we got our tests, and we definitely flew.
All right, and then moving on to the last member that is here, Sir Daniel Kalla.
On this note,
I have been a champion twice for the G-Men. This is the first time I've actually been on the field because of my shoulder. It feels extra special to do it this time, man. Yes, that's all I'm going to say, man. That's all I'm going to say, man. That's all I'm going to say. Yes, I'm proud of these guys. That's all I'm going to say.
Well, look, G-Men, I mean, any final words? Somebody step forward and close it here.
Look for G-Men 2011, baby.
Winter season.
Winter season.
Winter
coming.
Season, baby.
We're coming for you, Div 2. We're coming for you, Div 2.
Yes.
Okay, well, that's it. That's if there's anything to retain from that.
And again, thanks to the FPF staff, guys. Nothing but entertaining. I'm stuck at work all day refreshing the Flag Plus site.
Unfortunately, we got Darren, but it's okay. Darren, you did a great job.
All right, well, congratulations to all the G-Men.
Thank you, Darud.
Except Camus. Okay, and Camus, too, had a pretty good sick tackling, Camus.
Yes,
Camus. All right, guys. So, seriously.
Interesting man in the world, right?
And on behalf of John.
Do you know, I give a compliment, you know?
On behalf of John and Nathan, thank you to everybody.
Wait, before.
Yeah.
I'd like to say congratulations to Prestige Worldwide. They played a great game, honestly. Yep. Clean game.
Clean game.
True sportsmanship, and I have nothing but respect for them, so they worked their asses off. Congrats to them.
All right, well, Mr. PR lesson, Johnny Santino. That's right. Faris, Dan, Alex, Paul, Narek, congratulations to you guys and obviously John Young and Nathan on a hell of a season. And we'll see you guys in the winter to try and defend your crown.
You guys did a good job. Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Welcome back to the Weekly Extra Point Live Road Show, post-game show brought to you by Ray, Ross, and Darren. Let's break down the recap of the four finals that we had tonight at Catalonia. First finals, Division D, Race Star Wars. Your thoughts on this? Were you surprised by the outcome, given the fact that Mongoose did give the Patriot a good run for its money towards the end of the football game?
That's pretty much it. I mean, you know, I thought Mongoose would have a better start, but Patriot came off to a flying start. I mean, Chauvin, we have said it all year long, he's a league MVP. He proved it on both sides of the ball. Jason LaChapelle took him a little bit, you know, time to get going. I guess maybe the last week off, maybe he was a bit rusty. But once he got going, he made the game interesting. But I think Patriot were the better team. They proved it on every play. And in the end, it was tough for Mongoose to catch up to them.
All right, looking for next year here, Pats, Mongoose, where do you see these guys next year?
Honestly, I think they both have the talent to be in Division 4. I mean, if they're in Division 5, they're probably, you know, a lot better than the team that will be there. So I can see both teams competing and Patriot maybe even some of the better teams in Division 4.
Division C action here. We had our very own JP Mancini, who's not here with us.
Celebrating.
Eating pizza, from what he told us.
Eating pizza and drinking milk.
The victorious Briscoe High Hawks defeating the Triple MT on a last play, essentially, in which they made a big stop on defense. Ross, your thoughts on this football game? You know both teams very well in the pregame show that we did, but what made the difference for this team to win it over Triple MT?
Well, I think that basically the quarterback play and the stepping up from the role players from Briscoe High Hawks is really what pushed them over the edge. They came together after a first half that I wasn't so convinced that Briscoe High would be able to pull this one off, but they came together, they adapted their defense, Ben Joseph and JP Mancini basically restructured their defense at half. Omar Nyack played amazing at rusher in the second half in order to get enough pressure under Bishara and not escape the pocket. And at the end of the day, the team that made the most plays won, and effectively Bishara basically, I think, locked on too much to Eric, his brother, and that resulted in a loss.
All right, 2010, what do you foresee these two teams? Will they be in Division 3, Division 4, depending on how things play out?
Well, I think Briscoe High is suited if they can keep their core together to stay in Division, well, become a Division 3 team. At the same time, I think, MMIT is Dirty Birds, so they'll for sure be back in Division 3.
Division B, the G-Men essentially had this game in control from the get-go. They were up by as many as 20 points midway through the second half of the football game here, defeating Prestige Worldwide L.
Not so prestigious.
Because they became Prestige Worldwide losers because they lost this football game.
Easy.
No, they had a great season.
Talk about kicking somebody
down.
No.
Congrats to them on a job well done this year. But Darren,
he just didn't want, like, there would have been too many W's if they won. It would be triple W.
Exactly.
W-L with a loss.
Darren, looking at this football game here, what difference did Gianni Santino make? We saw the quarterback presence, the moxie that he had, finding the right guys at the right time. What difference was he in the football game? It seemed like he wasn't flustered at all.
I love missing Gianni.
Well, look, it was honestly, it was all the difference, because it was all going to be decided. Look, they were pretty well matched up, both teams, but the G-Men had Gianni Citino quarterback, PWW had Lever, and Lever just looked a little bit frazzled early on. It didn't look like he was in the game. He wasn't playing the game he wanted to play. Gianni Citino, on the other hand, was the most confident guy going into this game, despite the fact that this was his first championship game. And he showed it all throughout. Each time the Prestige Worldwide threatened to take control back in the game, Citino just connected with somebody for a deep bomb, or they matriculated the ball downfield. Really, they were able to do it all, despite the fact that they were missing Nathan Taylor, who's been a big key for them all season. Faris Kamel slipped into his spot at defense and stepped up big there. So really, it was a great team win. But I mean, hats off go to both teams for being there, but especially to Gianni Citino for his first championship as quarterback, and to Nari Gesayan, who got playoff MVP and was a stalwart for them all throughout the playoffs.
And let's not forget about Paul Kamel, who had a fabulous game in the finals, made some huge plays on defense and on offense that sealed the deal for the G-Men. All right, Division A, probably the closest out of the four matchups. A big win, 18-16 victory by the Mercenaries. Ray Sarwar, I'll start off with you first. The difference in this game was the defense, and this time around, it was the Mercenaries' defense that came up big when they had to.
Well, remember in the pregame, we were talking about, you know, when we're breaking the game down. I said, you know, with the Mercenaries, when they come together in the playoffs, it's a different team. And you saw right off the bat, they were making some big plays. Matt Norzel stepping up his game defensively. Steven Osman had an incredible game, who was the playoff MVP at the same time. You know, they were all making the big plays, Adi Sharma. I think they realized that, you know, they really had to play aggressive kind of football. They had the right guys, I think, in the right places, the coverage-wise. They had matching up. They matched up well against the Goodfellas receivers. So I think that was the main key in why their defense was successful.
Ross, Carmen Pellice did not have his best game, but he managed the game essentially here. He didn't force too many throws, and we saw the Goodfellas not capitalize on the mistakes that could have been created by Carmen. Was he the difference in this football game on the offensive side of the ball, at least?
I've got to actually disagree with you completely, based on the fact that Carmine threw two balls in the first half that were completely errant and, in his case, careless to his standards.
Both intercepted.
Both to Mark Champagne, which were intercepted. And in the second half, he still tested Springer down the right wing, and both were out into the rafter. So I don't think Carmen was 100% and took a safety. So I think Carmen, if anything, was off his game tonight.
Completely.
And that they were lucky that the defense of the Mercenaries for once this season showed up in order to pull out a huge win with that interception late in the second.
Looking at Benny Goodfriend here, Darren, I mean, last 12 months, he's lost the spring finals for the second consecutive year. He's won a winter title with Texas All-Stars. How would you rank him now, given the fact he had two opportunities to win it late in the second half of this football game but couldn't do so?
Well, I mean, look, Benny has accomplished a lot, both statistically, and he has won in his first championship as quarterback with Texas All-Stars. But until he wins the big one, again, it happened last time. Played a little bit last spring, played a little bit better this time than compared to last spring. The whole team did. That whole core is obviously the same as the Rough Riders of Happiness. But the fact of the matter is they did not elevate their game in the late drives. John Young came through with a huge sack for a safety on Carmen Pellice, gave them 5-6 plays to go in the end zone and win the game. They just weren't able to get it done. You know, they're steadily increasing and getting closer and closer, but until they come together with that, until Benny starts hitting all the guys, Mark Champagne did not see enough balls today, you know?
He dropped a couple too.
It's never all on the quarterback. But on the other hand, that's the one thing that we'll always remember, is that it's another loss for this core of players in the biggest stage here. So, you know, they just got to turn it up and come back with even hungrier next time.
Ricky Martin, yes or no, very quickly here, yes or no, if he had played, would he have been the difference in this game?
You know, obviously a player of that caliber will make a difference. He can make the big plays downfield, and, you know, he has a good hand, he has a strength, you know, he's a big enough player. But I think this game, like Darren said, you know, it's just didn't go in their favor. I don't think Ricky Martin would have been a huge difference. I think the Mercenaries played good enough defense no matter who was there.
Yes or no, Ross?
Definitely not. I think Ricky Martin's a liability sometimes for the Goodfellas because of his reputation, and they forced the ball to him. So him not being there could have been a blessing, in fact.
It's a mixed yes for me because on the one hand, look, obviously he's a great tool for them, and a lot of those deep he's a great especially on the deep post routes, a lot of times they go to him. This time they were going to Jamal Pierre, but Jamal Pierre, because he did step up his game offensively, made some big catches for this team, that so the absence was not felt as strongly as it could have. And, you know, hats off like I said, they played their best game. They gave it a good shot, but it just wasn't enough in the end, and the Mercenaries are the champs.
So there you have it, the recap of DA, DB, DC, and DD, completed by the four of us, the original members of the Weekly Extra Point Live. Who knows? Stay tuned. Stay tuned for 2011. But I guess this is the part where we come to the end and start giving our thank yous.
Yes.
So let's go through the order. How should we do this first?
All right, first off, let's go with the diligent staff of Flag Plus Football, all the scorekeepers we've had. Golden Boy 2.0, Alex Porras, but in addition, Eddie Tarabay, who was also scorekeeping during the season, and the other scorekeeper, Mike Bird, Ben Joseph, who joined the staff. Obviously, the Weppel guys, you know, Ross, Rayhan, Mo, myself, JP, Bomb Squad filled in, you know, and now he gets a championship to boot, which even furthers our claim that if you join the Weppel, you get a championship because both JP and Bomb Squad got their championships. Who am I leaving out here?
Oh, we forgot about, we leave that guy for last.
Yeah.
But I want to thank all the cameramen who was a part of this, Mike Bird, of course, Mike Palazza, and Eddie Tarabay.
Traps.
As much as we like to make fun of Eddie Tarabay for being not Mike Palazza-esque, we still love him to death no matter what. So
we'll not beat him in Street Fighter, ever.
Don't even think about it. I'm convinced today that
beat him in Street Fighter.
I'm convinced that he was playing Street Fighter during our tapings of the Weekly Extra Point Live.
I think our beloved floor director is going to give us one of these soon.
So yeah, and the
Wise words,
Mo Khan. And we want to thank Robert Capana, as Darren will always say.
For his vision.
His drive and leadership.
Yeah, it's like a Christmas card. You send the same Christmas card to the people over and over again, right? That's vision.
It's somebody counted, right?
Yeah. It's determination.
Those tapes he makes us listen to over and over.
Vision, determination. Without him, as I would say, we wouldn't be here. So we thank him for the opportunity to give us the platform to do what we do, which
I think I'd still be here.
You probably would. Ross,
I would have taken over.
I don't think so. Ray and I don't think so. So there you go. Without further ado, that's it. That's all. I want to thank all the people who partook in the Spring League. Well done by you guys.
Yeah. Players.
It's all about the players.
Their parents for
the referees them. As well. Cannot forget about those guys. Without them, who would be blowing the whistles, right?
Players' girlfriends for making it interesting.
So, absolutely. Yeah.
And you know, just another nod to the players. Obviously, this was a weird season. It started off with some kind of altercation every week for the first 5 weeks.
Firework.
But then throughout the rest, everything was well played. We had incredible playoffs. Four great games today. You know, it's just, we do it for the players. I find we got a lot more feedback than we usually do, positive feedback.
Definitely.
People are appreciative. But we appreciate what you guys do and how you guys participate as well, and keep it up. We'll be back in the winter.
And again, without further ado, look forward to any news and notes that will come up during the fall. So check out your emails,
Flag Plus Wall,
and even the FPF site and the Facebook site as well.
Yeah.
Check that out as any updates for winter 2010, which is not too far away, actually. We're only 4 months away. How about that?
Yeah.
4 months away and about 8 months from the roadshow?
Yeah, exactly.
32 till the next roadshow.
And without further ado, Darren, the magic words, please.
That's it from us here at the hair. That's it. It's been a long day. All right, take two.
All right, Darren, time for the magic words, please.
All right. That's it from us here at the Weekly Extra Point Live Roadshow Spring 2010 edition. We will see you here in the winter, some of us, hopefully. But until then,
good night. Spring 2010. We'll see you January 8th and 9th, which we project will be the first week of the FPF season in 2011.
Projected.
We the best!
Challenge to 2011.
It's too late.
Watch me not stop, though.